And this is not just about individuals, and those individuals are important, but it's about community, Lord. The gathering of the saints in need of renewal, the gathering of the simple who do not know you. And so we ask, Lord, that your Spirit will be poured out this evening and tomorrow evening and the next evening and every day, Lord, especially over the lives who are gathered here, that your Spirit will continue to be poured out, reminding us, keeping before us the living and risen Lord Jesus Christ, and that we will follow him as Lord and proclaim him as Savior. So Lord, prepare our hearts for worship this evening. Prepare our hearts to receive our King. Prepare our hearts to hear your word. Prepare our hearts to have that word change our life. We ask all of this name of Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior. Amen. Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah, I do call those enjoyance prayers. I just felt your Spirit with my Spirit, and we came into the presence of the Lord, and that's where we are right now. And we're going to open up this worship in a little bit. I've got a few pastors to introduce here. It's Greg Cyphers. Yeah, he's with us tonight. And we have Daryl Bowling with us. I didn't think you could hide from me for long. There you are. And so welcome, and thank you for your service and your ministry in our community. Many years of service and witnessing to the love of God and Jesus Christ. So thank you for being here with us tonight. It's a blessing to have you with us. And we have with us as music, Travis is going to be with Russ, thank you for being, everybody knows Russ, I think, and Vanessa, his wife, is here, Braxton, is that right? And that's Moses over there, okay, so, I'm sorry, you must be part of this beautiful family, too, and are you?
I'm the grandmother.
That's what I figured, I knew that, okay, So we're going to have Russ Cyphers and Darlene Moore blessing us with their musical gifts tonight as a praise to God, I believe. And then it's always a pleasure for me to introduce, the more I hear him talk and the stories he tells, I can call him an old friend now. the Reverend Bill Hobbs, who was a pastor here in Pound and Gladeville and Wise, and became part of this community. I don't know why he left, but I think they chased him out. I don't know. No. When I went away to the mission field for 26 years, I figured my congregations in Marion, that they sponsored me all those years so I wouldn't come back. but here we are, folks, and we are truly blessed with a scriptural teacher and pastor and preacher. And it was over 30 years ago, the first time I heard Bill Hobbs preach, I knew I wanted to hear more. I knew he could teach me something that even seminary didn't get into me. so the Lord used him in that week to move me as a young pastor into new understandings and new insights. So I'll just say that thank you publicly. Okay, thank you for letting God use you that way, Bill. So let's enter into worship now, okay? I'll be reading from Psalm 21. The king rejoices in your strength, Lord. How great is his joy in the victories you give. You have granted him his heart's desire and have not withheld the request of his lips. You came to greet him with rich blessings and placed a crown of pure gold on his head. He asked you for life, and you gave it to him. Length of days, forever and ever. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we know that those words were uttered by King David, and he was in his own circumstance and setting in which he offered up his rejoicing. But he knew that you were the living God, a loving God, a gracious God, a God who honors his promises and covenant relationship. And so, Lord, as we gather, we humble ourselves before you. We do ask you, Lord, to forgive us for our sins. We do recognize and acknowledge that you are holy and righteous, beyond our imagination, and yet you have seen fit to pursue us with your love and your grace, your forgiveness, and the salvation that we have received or is there before us. Light and truth and life. So Lord, let your Spirit anoint our worship leaders, our musicians, our preacher this evening. And may our prayers that begin in our hearts move to our lips, to heaven. May you hear them and touch our souls this night. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. So we invite our musicians up here for a little song. Songs. Sing as many as you need. However the Spirit moves you. Wish I could sing too.
So tonight we're going to open as a congregation with How Great Thou Art. It's on page 147. If everyone wants to stand with us.
Oh, God would give him a son. Blessed Isaac was his name, the greatest gift he'd ever known. Then came the day, who would have dreamed that God would say, you've got to give it to me. Now on this mountain you must prove it's you and Isaac, or it's me. My eyes is
singing, I was threatened. I enjoyed it. It was wonderful. But I failed to introduce Mimi. I make these mistakes. And so please know that Bill isn't here by himself, but he's probably here because his wife got him here, Mimi. And so thank you for being with us too, Mimi. And the other thing that I forgot to say is that there are some wonderful, delicious cookies and some decaf coffee and things to have after the service this evening. And you can't go during the sermon or at the end there, okay? But, okay, sorry. Bill, would you please take this out of my hands?
Like that, it's going to be a big letdown when I talk. I made some improvements on my preparation. I've got it all on a 3-point card. And I can't wander as much, maybe, when I have only that much written down, although not necessarily so. So we have a few new people, so let me tell you what we've been doing. This is an assignment I was given. So if it doesn't strike you as appropriate, you just talk to Michael, and it's his fault. He heard me do something at, it must have been at Royal Oak Church in Mary. So I was 36 years old then. And things worked a lot better upstairs when I was 36 years old than they do now. I'm 71. And I was a lot smarter. I won't say I was a more godly man. That would be not untrue. I hope I am a more godly man today. I'm humbler today. That's good, right? That's good. We've been looking then at Romans. It seems like a long time ago, but yesterday morning we looked at what the gospel is. I ran across another definition. Y'all know J.I. Packer, he's just died in the last few months. J.I. Packer, he was an Englishman, a very godly man, great writer. I heard him lecture once, crystal clear. He wrote a book, Knowing God, which I'm now about my fourth or fifth time teaching through. And why I didn't read this a lot sooner in life, I don't know. This is a book written, he says it's got some doctrine in it, you have to do that. But it was written for doxology and praise. And every single chapter will drive you to the Lord on your knees. It's a great thing. Things that you were singing just now, this book so far. I thought that's an advertisement. Anyway, I've got a lot of ideas. What made me think of it was a quote I ran across. I don't even know if it's in that book. Because our first lessons were on the gospel. What is the gospel? The good news. And this is Packer's definition. Let me give you an idea how a great mind, he was a child prodigy, very great mind, with faith, with God's hand, applied to Scripture. Here's his definition of gospel. Of course, the handwriting I have is so tiny, I can't even see it. The gospel is the story of how our judge became our Savior. That's better than what I did yesterday and today. How our judge became our Savior. Now, We looked at the gospel yesterday morning twice, well, two places. And then last night we looked at the cross, the paragraph in chapter 3 from verses 21 to 26, often called the greatest paragraph ever written. I just touched on it. It's a paragraph. A lot of ink has been spilled trying to peel apart all that Paul thought to say about Jesus Christ's death in our place. That day at Calvary Hill. It's a great paragraph. We'll start from there in a moment. I just call that one the cross or the gospel for us, our gospel. Then tonight, what I'm doing is faith. What is faith? Saving faith. I'm not talking about faith that might rain. I'm talking about saving faith. The kind of faith that will get you to glory. The kind of faith that's been sung about just here, right? If you can sing "How Great Thou Art," and that comes from your heart, I don't need to tell you anything about faith. You're all set. I just need to tell you, stick with that course. And for that matter, if the Lord has put you on that course, He'll stick with you and be fine. Well, that's tonight. What is faith? And then tomorrow night, from Romans 8, what is hope? What is our hope? Christian hope. What is it? So we look at Romans 8, 28-39. We'll look at our hope, and then, Lord willing, on Wednesday evening, we'll go to chapter 12 and take up the therefore. Therefore, in view of the mercies of God. Then Paul talks about what is a life lived like in thanksgiving to God for all His mercy. That's the project, okay? So now, we got to look at faith. That little paragraph I read and looked at some with you last night, after that, in verse 27 in chapter 3, and then on for 30 verses, Paul actually opens up that paragraph. He just keeps going. But he looks at one word, and I told you last night I was going to skip. I talked about the righteousness of God, which is on display nowhere else in human history better than the cross. Because at the cross, sin was damned and judged, and salvation was delivered at one and the same time. In the same act, the judge and the Savior act. Most of them, there is nothing like it. Remember, I gave you a very famous theologian, a Scottish man in the early part of the 20th century, when someone told him that he had been a liberal, he was converted after becoming a professor. Someone told him that he was describing something that was impossible. He said, "It's not impossible, it's just a miracle." Right? Well, when a theologian can say that, it's okay for us to say that. So then Paul does at verse 27, and then all the way through chapter 4, he takes this notion that's in the last phrase. It's actually twice in that section. The word faith appears four times, but you have this, that the righteousness of God at the present time is on display, so that He, that is God, might be just, that is righteous, punishing sin, as He says He will, and at the same time, the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. That's the mirror. He's just, righteous, and He saves sinners. And so the rest of the way through, he used the word faith another 24 times in 37 verses to describe faith. He looks at Abraham, sang a song, beautiful song, a great song. I better be able to find that on the internet because I've never heard that. It's beautiful. Yeah. But that picture, Genesis 22, that picture of what God asked Abraham to do, and theology, that's all straight up. That's what Paul does, is to take a look at how there is this, continuity. There is this thing happening in the old book. And while there's lots new in the new book, there's stuff that's pushed on through, and we just find out that Jesus carried it all out, finished it. But the project was started on page 3 when Eve was told she'd have a Savior for a son, right? Somebody who would crush Satan. So that project, prophesied way back there, has been carried all the way through until you get to the cross, and there it's delivered, right? So, but the what, now we have to take up. So we've seen righteousness, and we looked at justification last night. I know it's complicated. I'm not going to apologize. These are words Paul uses. We looked at justification, right? Just as if I'd never sinned. He teaches what he looked. We looked at redemption, and we looked at that harder word, propitiation, turning aside the wrath of God, which had been the subject of 64 verses before that. But we didn't look at faith. So the question now, here's what Jesus did. He redeemed us. He's justified us. If we have faith, He has paid the price of our sin and declared us not guilty, given us the credit for His righteousness. So we have that thing the Puritans called the divine exchange. He got our sin. We got his perfect righteousness. And then he paid for the wrath of God. All those are one act. But how do you get it? How do you have it? How is it ours? Because we are sinners. And there isn't anybody else in the world. Famous Old Testament theologian once said, you know, it would have been nice had God used better material. Right? Only he couldn't find it. That's the problem. And so what God has to do is use bent sticks. That's just the way it is. Because there are not any better material in the world. Everybody God has access to is people like us. So then this project, this faith, I'm going to read a little bit of this path, this piece, to get a flavor for it, and then we're going to talk about what is faith. But, you know, you may think, well, I know it's just trusting something so. You're on the right track. But saving faith has to have certain characteristics. We meet people all the time and say, oh, you know, he's a person of faith. Or, you know, worse, he's very spiritual. Muslims are very spiritual. And I know people who are spiritual, but that's not the same as being a friend of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right? So we need. That's what we're going to do. Let me read a little bit, and then off we go. All right.
Phil, why don't you speak up just a little bit?
All right. Thank you. Hold on, Wes. You got to raise your hand when you don't hear me. All right.
Got to turn the microphone. You're good.
Can you hear me all right?
I can pick you up good on the microphone.
Oh, well, that gets me. So four people are watching online. y'all are blessed, but I got all these people in here I need to talk to. You know, that was another thing that was a lot better 35 years ago with the boys. All right. Wave your hand, Wes, when you see I'm not doing it. Wave it around. I won't call on you. All right, so let me read a little bit in this piece. I'm going to pick it up. I'm going to reread that little paragraph and then go a little ways so you'll get the drift of what Paul wants to do. And remember, he took 30 more verses to be sure, just like that thing on sin. Remember, it seemed like 64 verses on sin is overkill. But it's not. Most people don't believe it applies to them. And so Paul went on and on, first showing the world for what it is. And he knew after you read Romans 1, you read that chapter, and if you're not puffed up and proud, you're unusual. And so the very next thing he does in chapter 2 of Romans is say, now you who pick on those people, you're just proud and arrogant and self-righteous, and you're worse than them. And so Paul does it because he knows how that comes across when you hear someone who's a terrible sinner. Sometimes we're humbled and wonder, well, there but for the grace of God go on. But sometimes we're like, well, that's terrible. That's just awful. And Paul did not want to let us off that way. All right, so same way here with faith. He's told exactly how it is, but he wants to now, he goes on another 30 verses to explain how it is that we could have the benefit of somebody else's work credited to us. All right, here we go. All right, glasses off so I can see. I can't see y'all, but I'm seeing the book. Now the righteousness, I'm in verse 21. Now remember, this is the word of God. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested, seen, shown, apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. When we talked about that, how the law, I read from Isaiah 52 last night, and said, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. The word believe in the original comes from the same word as faith. It's just a funny thing about English. There's no distinction. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Remember I told you the original verb, there's one word, it could be all have sinned and lack, and do not have the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift. Remember the passage, we talked about those. God is doing the justifying. Through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood, just by his life. Life poured out. To be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he passed over former sins. So it always seemed to people that God didn't care. Now the cross proves that's not right. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. very much like Ephesians 2 here. Then what becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of a law? By law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that no one is justified by faith apart, that one is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. Is this God the God of the Jew only? Is he not the God of Gentiles also? Yes, Gentiles also, since God is one. Who will justify the circumcised by faith, that is the Jew, and the uncircumcised through faith? Do we then overthrow the law by this faith? No, by no means. On the contrary, we uphold the law. You had already said in chapter 2, the law is beautiful. The law is not the problem. We're the problem, right? The law only shows an unbeliever his sin. Now for us, you know, a Christian, the law can be a beautiful roadmap to holiness if you have the Spirit. So what then will we say was gained by Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, well, then he had something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the Scripture say? Abraham, this is the Genesis 15, 6 quote that you pick up here, Genesis, Galatians 3, and then in James, interesting. Abraham believed God, and it was counted or credited or imputed to him as righteousness. Theologians call this the alien righteousness, right? The righteousness of another. Now, the one who works, well, his wages aren't counted as a gift, but as his due. As the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly. There's the phrase. Believes in him who justifies the ungodly. That's the line. God justifies the wicked. That's the crazy thing. His faith, you see, is counted as righteousness. And then he goes on to quote David in the beautiful Psalm 32, and I'm allowed to go with that and talk to you a little bit. But that chapter goes all the way through. He picks up how Jesus pays for wrath, and but it's really an exposition of what we have, what is in that earlier paragraph. Now, let me. Let's talk a little bit about definitions, all right? Well, first I want to do this. Before we define faith, let's try to understand why would God do this. I'm just working on the edge of Scripture here, right? But it's worth thinking about. Why would God? What if we said before that God justified people on the basis of works? And you know people who believe that we're justified by works. You meet people who think you have to do a certain number of things. Question always is, how much? And what a terrible position to be in. Roman Catholics do that. All the world's religions do that. I've met some Protestants who somehow think, I met a lady here in Wise once, not a member of the church, but she was visiting, and her preacher husband had died recently, and she was visiting a friend, and I said, well, one day soon, you'll be with him again. And she said, well, I just hope I'm good enough. That's the wrong thing to say. That's the fighting thing to say. Because you won't ever be good enough. There's not a soul in this room to be good enough to go be with Jesus. That's not the issue. Jesus was good enough to be with Jesus. He's the King. And you get there on the strength of your love for him, which shows that he has loved you first. All right, well, so why faith? Because the works we take the credit for. That keeps us proud. And the whole point here in Ephesians 2, where is the place of boasting? It doesn't exist. There is no place for boasting. Andrew Bonar, you may have run across him, his brother, Horace, was a fine hymn writer. He says, why is faith so important? It's because it empties us of self. It empties us of self. And it gives all the glory. That's why. Now, if you want to do a little speculating back in Genesis, some guys don't like this. Before Adam and Eve sinned, they had a perfect word from God, perfect provision from God. And then they began to take the word of someone else. That's not faith. See, where the things started going wrong is where it has to get back on track. To believe the testimony, to believe the word of God. All right, I'll give you a definition of faith. There are a lot of definitions I could give you. Here's one from an older catechism. What is faith in Jesus Christ? Faith in Jesus Christ is a saving grace whereby we receive and rest upon Him alone for salvation, just as it's offered to us in the gospel. I keep that little book of catechism back there to remind me what I'm supposed to think. Now, I want to tell you a couple of the most important things about faith, and they're in that definition, but they're in this passage too. First, faith, any kind of faith, has an object, right? Any kind of faith has an object, right? That light is shining. The object of my confidence that that's true is that it is shining. I'm not having a philosophy class here. Is that really shining, or are we in darkness just imagining together? That's not my cup of tea. That light is shining, and I'm confident in it. Now there, I'm arguing from my sight, right? So are you. If you're sighted, that's how we're doing that. But that's our confidence. Faith, every kind of faith has some object. Saving faith has one only object, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. It cannot be faith. A lot of people say they have faith, and when you hear that, you may not know them well enough to quiz them, but if you know them well enough to ask them, what is it you believe? Because I've had people tell me, I believe it's all going to turn out all right. That is not saving faith. That's just paganism. That's not saving faith. I believe I'm going to heaven. Well, I'm glad for that. Why do you think you're going to heaven? You might be, you might not be. Faith, saving faith, has one object, the Lord Jesus Christ. His person and what he's done, what he did at the cross. Okay? That's really important. What one man once said, with faith, you have to remember, it is personal, that is, it in a person. It's in a person. And it's also proposition. It's based on propositions. That's the second thing I want us to talk about. The saving faith is based on the testimony of Scripture. It comes to us, this passage, and lots of the Bible, it comes to us as the testimony from God. It's God's testimony. We are looking at God's gospel. Remember, we said that yesterday morning. That's how Paul introduced the whole letter. The gospel of God, God's gospel. This is God's version of how the world works. It's God's version of sin. It's God's version of salvation. There are plenty of alternatives. Go to any bookstore and go to the self-help section. They used to have a religious section, but they can't do that anymore, so they have a section that's just got all kind of gobbledygook. And then here and there, a really good book. It'd be funny how you go to those places and you say, well, look at this. Sometimes you get a pretty good discount in those places when they're tucked away. So you have the divine testimony, and you have the person of Christ. The third thing. It's the three most important things in this definition of faith. The third thing. Faith is a supernatural gift. That's very important. Because people fall into the trap of saying, I need to have more faith. I just can't get there. I just got to develop it. As though faith was a work. They treat faith like something you do. We do express it. But it's from heaven. God gives it. Ephesians 2, verse 8. It is salvation by grace through faith. And it is a gift of God that no man might boast before the Lord. Another place most people don't think of, in Philippians, where there was some grousing going on in the church, evidently, and a pride problem. You pick it up early in the letter. And Philippians, he says in verses 27, 28, 29 of chapter 1, it has been given to you not only to believe, but also to suffer. And this is an aside, but you know, I didn't pick Romans 5 and the early part of Romans 8. But the Apostle Paul says, I rejoice. First he said 5, he says, I rejoice in my freedom, in my justification. The second thing he says, and I rejoice in my suffering, because look at all the good fruit that has come from suffering. Right? That's the way. You know that hymn? I carry a hymn around in my pocket. It's a John Newton hymn from the late part of the 1779. You know the hymn, I ask the Lord that I might grow? You know the hymn? I ask the Lord that I might grow in faith and love and every grace, might more in his salvation know and seek more earnestly his face. He was the one who taught me thus to pray, and he, I trust, has answered my prayer, but it has been such a way that almost drove me to despair. I had hoped that in some favored hour, at once, this is the way we all are, at once he'd grant me my request and by his love's constraining power, subdue my sins and give me rest. Indwelling sin. You've been nasty? Horrible, horrible. Instead of this, he made me feel the hidden evils of my heart. And he let the angry powers of hell assault my soul in every place. Yea, more, with his own hand, he seemed intent to aggravate my woe. He crossed all the fair designs I schemed. He blasted my gorge, old expression, beat me up. And he laid me low. Lord, why is this? I cried, trembling. Wilt thou pursue this worm to death? Said the Lord, 'Tis in this way I answer prayer for grace and faith. These inward trials I employ from self and pride to set thee free, to break the schemes of worldly joy, so that you might seek all in me. So that's on growth in faith. But you see the place Newton understood that faith is from God. It's a gift of God. It is, all of this in Romans 3, you see, is to explain to us that faith, I'll give you another illustration, but faith is a gift that unlocks the door of heaven. It's the key. Here's my favorite illustration now. I maybe found this in an old book. Leon Morris, the Australian commentator, a book on the atonement. It's a beautiful thing. He has this illustration from his early life. He said, when I was a very young man, a minister, we had an annual church picnic, and even in Australia they have annual church picnics. And he said, I was a young man, I was big, and I was assigned the job of carrying this 4-gallon urn of I would say Gatorade, it was long before that company was invented, but some kind of fruit juice. And the children were playing like mad, and he said, it's one little boy, little tiny fellow, had come in from the picnic from the playground, and he was hot and red and sweaty. And he looked terrible. And here I had this giant big urn of everything he needed, all that he could possibly need. But he didn't have a cup. Didn't have a cup. And I looked all around. And everything he needed I had. But he had no way to get it. And I had no way to get it. And then another man came up who saw us and handed him a cup. And I poured into that cup everything he needed, and more. I had more than he could use. And that comes faith. You can't get all the blessings of God, although God has them all for you. You can't get them without faith. So that's as good as I know for an illustration. So those are the basic things. The object is Jesus. It's based on the clear testimony of Scripture. I know there's some passage of Scripture that worries. Everybody's got them. Calvin said there were 4 or 5. He spent his whole life, he was a smart man. He said there were 4 or 5 he hadn't figured out. He said, that's okay. Someone who comes along after me will get it. I know they're true. I just don't understand. All right, well, I have more than 5, but that's okay. But you see, based on the divine testimony, we know how God saves sinners. And we know it's all line in first chapter 1, verse 16, 17. It's all faith, all grace, all God. Right? There's some more things. Wednesday night, we're going to talk about how faith always bears fruit. In Ephesians 2, that'll be Romans 12. But in Ephesians 2, Paul says that we were saved not by works. What's the preposition? You know, prepositions and sentences are a big deal. They're important. You don't maybe know it, but they are. So we're not saved by works. That's the old way. That's the old way of thinking. That's the world's way of thinking. But we are saved for works. We're saved for works that God has prepared beforehand for us to walk in or to do, right? So the works are not unimportant, but we don't do them as duty. We do them on the mercies of God. We do them in thanksgiving to God for his kindness to give us the privilege of being the sons and daughters of God. Well, anyway, that's for Wednesday night, so I can't talk more about that. It is the instrument of justification, but I just did that. It's the thing, that's that paragraph, it's the thing that unlocks the door. It's the thing. God has chosen to unlock the door, but he also chose to give it. What a sorry world we live in if God required something that we couldn't do. Won't that sink in a second? Because that's this world. Everything God requires, you can do, and I can do. Unless he gives you faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Right? Without faith, it is impossible. It's not going to make your works better. Don't you have neighbors who are better people than you? I do. I've got neighbors who take cookies to new people in the neighborhood before I do. They're always beating me at the punch. Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones, a famous English Welshman, preached in England. He said, you know, they have the motive of trying to feel better about themselves. And sometimes they get ahead of it. There's only one motive. For any work we do, there's only one motive that God counts. And that's, you see, the difference. You know where motive plays in a deed, right? If somebody runs a person down on the side of the road because they spilled coffee or a bee got in the car, that's a terrible thing, a terrible thing. But it's a lot different than if somebody drives down the road, sees them on the shoulder, looks around, and runs them down on purpose, right? Is a person dead both ways? Sure. Is there a difference between that deed? Yes, there is. And what's the difference? The motive. So it is with God. And we learn that from God. Here the difference is we do works for the blessing of Jesus Christ in thanksgiving to God, not to earn anything from God, because we know that all of our deeds are nothing. But we hope that they please Jesus Christ. And we want to do them in thanksgiving and honor to him. That's a part of faith. That's what faith does. It teaches us to serve others. Jesus, I told you the other day, is sometimes called the man for others. He lived his whole life for others and said, follow me to us. Right? Okay, so now let's look at another thing. Faith, we often think of faith, I think I've pointed this direction, but faith is the way in and it's the way on. Right? It's the way in. It's the God's the way. It's God's way of opening the door to us. But it's also the way forward. It's the way of the Christian life. We live by faith. That little quote from Habakkuk. If you go back to Habakkuk 2 and see its context, it's a kind of a wait and see faith. Habakkuk's complaining about the godlessness in Israel in his day, and he wants God to do something about it. God says, just have faith. You'll see. Faith is the way forward. It's not just the way in. Right? So we live by faith every day, every morning. Don't you pray in the morning? Oh, Lord, it's your day. I know some of you who pray, Lord, show me something I could do for Jesus Christ this day. That's called living faith in a living Lord. Right? Okay. Another thing we can say about faith, this will take us a little bit to tomorrow night. Faith sustains our hope. I'm talking about the Christian hope. So all those great questions we're going to look at tomorrow night from Romans 8. What shall we say to all these things? And I'll go over all that. You know, if God is for us, I'll give you a taste for the moment. If God is for us, who is against us? That's the first of Paul's four great questions. But if you turn back six or seven pages, keep that line in mind. And I'll read you something, see what you think. That's 8:30, 31. If God is for us, who is it who's against us? Got that line? I'm going to turn back three pages. This is chapter 1, verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. Who is the enemy, the great enemy of wickedness? God is. And yet, after five pages on Jesus Christ, if God is for us, who's against us? Pretty interesting distinction, isn't it? I mean, something happened between 118 and 834, worth knowing about. He says, how is it that we move from being the object of God's wrath, fairly, honestly, truly, righteously, to becoming the objects of his mercy? Somewhere in the middle there, Jesus had done something very great. And faith has united us to him. And we have that great blessing. Well, that's what we're going to work on tomorrow night. I didn't waste my voice already with that sport. So if you look at this chapter 4 about the hope that Abraham had, there's a couple places. Remember the great one, which will be obvious to you, and that was in the song. Okay, there was a piece about Abraham, you're going to have a son. He's an old man, wife's as old as he is almost, and they were simply, the scripture tells us plainly, it's not like those are primitive people and didn't understand how these things work. They live straight up. She's not having any children because they're both past the age, right? In hope, he believed against hope that he should become the father of nations. Not just, first it was just to be a father. That's impossible. And then the father of nations, that's ridiculous. Remember how God took him in 15, took him outside and said, look up there. They talked about the sand on the seashore, trying to give him an idea. And who are the children of Abraham according to Paul in Romans 4? We are. Not that we have the blood of Abraham. Paul in Romans 9 has to tell the Jews, look, the blood of Abraham's not anything. That's not the important thing. That's not what it means in the Bible to be a child of Abraham. To be a child of Abraham means you have not the blood of Abraham, but the faith of Abraham. To believe God for the impossible. Well, that's another thing about faith. It's often tied up to the impossible. Most of the time, we're afraid to pray for the impossible. Aren't we? We are afraid to pray for the impossible. Because we're afraid that it'll go wrong and our faith will be hurt. You're not afraid about God. We're afraid if I pray for the impossible and it doesn't happen, then my faith will get weaker. I'll be shaky on God. Will God be shaky? Does God get the freedom to decide where he acts? Be careful. We often speak of human freedom. I don't know why we do that. You're no more free than a dog in a cage. We're not free. We're constrained by so many things. Jesus said anybody who keeps sinning is a slave to sin. And if you're not a slave to sin, the only other kind of slave, there are two kinds of slaves in the world. Slaves to sin and slaves to Jesus Christ. Paul always introduced his life. Paul, slave of Jesus Christ. Somebody else is called the shots. And you know, there's no slavery worse than being a slave to your own desires. That's the worst kind of slavery that is. Isn't it true? Maybe I'm the only one who knows that, but I can tell you it's true. Now, then you keep going. When he gets to chapter 5, he says, I rejoice that we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace with God. I'm just trying to give you some of the fruit of faith. In that chapter, he says, if you go through the market like in mine, one great blessing after another is the fruit of this little thing that God gives, the seed of faith. And it can grow. We're taught to pray for it. Abraham grew strong in the faith. That little hymn I read you. Lord, I want to grow strong in the faith. Don't ever pray anything like that. That's like the old joke. I prayed for patience. What a mistake that was. Because you know, when you pray for something and you really want it and you pray to the right person, which is the Lord Jesus, he'll set about to do it. And you pray for courage, he's going to give you something scary. Right? You pray for kindness, he's going to give you somebody you don't like. God knows how to bend our hearts the right way. So if you pray, whatever you pray for, you're likely to get the opposite and see how you do. And hopefully, you know, God likes humble people. You know, in heaven, they used to say, heaven is the peculiar favorite or the humble are the peculiar favor of heaven. The truth is, there aren't any proud people in heaven. Pride, selfishness, those belong somewhere else. So faith, Abraham, you look at the lives of the great patriarchs. Look at Jacob. How did he start? That's one of the worst cases of bad raw materials you'll find in the whole Bible. It just, what a miserable, he just needed a horseman. But that's not what God did. And you notice all the way along, how did God grow him up to be a patient man, but to give him a lion and sheep and Laban, uncle, just like he had been to his older brother, right? So he was taught a lesson over, and how, did it take 2 weeks? Did it take a couple of years? Did it take two seconds? It took a long time. God's not in a hurry. And he teaches us by the means of our own sin, by breaking us, humiliating us, growing our faith, so that at some point we say, Lord, just have your way. And you'll him, have thine own way, Lord. Have your way, Lord. I don't know which way to go. When he gets to Romans 8, the beginning, he says, Lord, so often I pray. This is the apostle, this great, brilliant scholar. Lord, I don't even know how to pray. I don't know what to say. Haven't you? We have that, don't we? Something's happening. We say, Lord, do something. But I don't know which way. That's okay. The Spirit knows. He knows our grief over it. So we just say, Lord, you do it. You do it. And then make, if you don't mind, make me satisfied with the way you did it. That's what faith does. Faith gives us peace at heart that God's at work, doing his thing his way, and his way is always better than ours. We think we know better, but we don't know better. All right, we'll close with an illustration. How am I doing? I'm okay on time? You're not the one to ask. You don't care about time. You never ask a preacher about time. That is never a good idea. All right. There's a bumper. You know, I have not seen it here, and we may not have it. There's a bus back to our main point now. I want to get you on the whole business of faith. His object is Jesus. What the Bible says is true. That's our testimony of how faith works. And it's God's precious gift. No finer gift can be, because it brings us into the fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ, the King of glory, the living God. There's a bumper sticker where I live. It's on the back of a lot of cards. It says, just pray. Do you believe in prayer? I do. I don't pray nearly enough. People say when I pray out loud, well, you're a great praying person. I hate them to say that. I've paid for years and years to pray in public. But I'm not a great prayer warrior. Oftentimes, I'm not even as good as Paul. I just say, Lord, my heart is empty. I don't know what to say to you, but I know I'm talking to the right place. But I just don't know what to say. This has been as lousy a day as ever was lived for you, if any minute was lived for you. My attitude has been sorry. I went to visit somebody, I didn't want to go, I wanted to stay in my office, and then they were nicer to me than I was to them. Now I feel even worse than the day when I started. I'm glad you laughed, because it irritates me to know him. Just pray. So you see that bumper sticker and you say, Tess, that's great. You know what the origin of that bumper sticker is? It's a part of a revival. We like that word. It's a part of a Roman Catholic revival to get people to pray to Mary. See, that's not right. Mary doesn't have any extra credits of glory. In the Magnificat, she thanks God, her Savior, same as you and me. She was just a godly lady. God chose to bring forth the Savior. She wasn't a perpetual virgin. She does not have any extra credits to give you when you pray. She's not going to get hold of her son and get his attention for you. There's only one high priest in glory, and his name is Jesus Christ. That's the only person you can pray to. I am the only way to the Father. Nobody comes to him but through me. Period. So just saying you're a praying person is meaningless unless you are talking to the one who can make it happen, and that's Christ, the Lord Jesus, and nobody else. See, I want you to remember, if nothing else, faith is a special thing, a special privilege that you have that not so many people have, and that you know the one you have faith in, how blessed you are. Because you're going to spend eternity with him and his people. And there you will pray, believe it or not. You won't have a copy of scriptures. You will see him as he is. And probably what you'll do is what we heard. And I just hope one day I have a voice to do it that way. But probably the Lord Jesus doesn't care. A joyful noise is what Psalm 100 says, and that's about what I do. But if it's a joyful noise, that's what we'll be doing. And I think we have jobs. The only difference between a job in glory and a job here, you'll never be frustrating there, and you'll love every minute. But faith is the only way you're going to get it. Faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Right? So we looked at gospel, we looked at the cross, which makes it all possible. So now we've looked at faith. I hope you got something on that. And Lord willing, tomorrow night we'll look at hope. And then we'll look, tonight, at being transformed. Okay. Thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you.
The Lord bless you. I'm going to pray.
You pray.
Me pray? I just said my prayers are out. All
right, preachers don't have any concept of time. That's because we're getting closer to eternity.
Just a few minutes closer, and I have benefited you in that respect.
Yeah, I do.
All right, let me pray for you. Great God in heaven and our Redeemer, Father, thank you, O Lord God, for your gospel. Thank you, O Lord God, that you didn't abandon us as you might well have done in justice and righteousness, and left us to our own devices, to wander about aimlessly in this world, making a mess of everything we touched. No, Lord God, that didn't satisfy you. Though we deserve it, you were not satisfied. And you did the impossible. You sent the Son of your love, our Lord Jesus, with only one purpose, to die. And it was such a great payment, O Lord, that that blood covers all our sin. Not just some of the sins, not just the easy sins, not any of that. All our sins. Cleansing us from all unrighteousness, O Lord God. Who else but you could have come up with a plan like that? And I thank and praise you for it. And I pray, Lord, for each of us that we might rejoice this day in such a great salvation. That we might seek to serve you, to bless you in our praying, in our thinking, in our feelings, in our speech, in our actions. Lord, make us a people. I ask your mercies always in that great name, Jesus Christ.
Amen. While the musicians get set up, thank you, Bill, for opening up the door of faith, something other than a concept, you know? And so what I would say to all of us tonight, because as we are, you guys, just go ahead and do what you're doing. And everybody keeps going, who's in charge here? I'm in charge right now. as our musicians play some more music for us, I want you to picture faith. Faith is right here. And your hearts have known faith. And that faith is here. Jesus says, I stand at the door and knock. And that could be that we need to have some prayers for us.
could be that we want something to stir in us, that we have this desire. God's Spirit is bringing us to this faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, who is our Savior. And I say our Savior. And if Jesus is not your Lord and Savior, that faith is right here. Not because of the building, not because of where we are, not because of the wonderful words that Bill said, but because of the words that God spoke to us. And Bill interpreted for us. And I would also say that there's opportunities for the renewal of what we thought we experienced at some point in our life. We said, yeah, that's what it was. Where'd it go? Renew it in me. Bring me into your grace. Bring me into your love by faith. Change my life. So I invite you, while the singers are singing, this row is reserved for you. We'll pray with you. We'll receive you. We'll listen to you. All you need is an ear. I'm here. But that faith is going to be right there waiting for you. Okay? Of faith, hope, and love. We are the church, the body of Christ. And that's the big C. That's not a, we're not dividing up the pie. Okay? So, talking big C, community of faith, hope, love, and witness. And We have this thing in our congregations that COVID helped us to develop. We say, the peace of the Lord be with you. And we turn around, we wave at each other like this. And some people wiggle their fingers like this. And I would like to have our Presbyterian culture here raise their hands in a hallelujah for the sermon, and that in the peace of the Lord be with you. You see, they can get up there. They can get up there. Okay. Now, we're going to be singing a congregational closing song. And the cookies are in there. And you can raise your hands if you want to. Okay?
So in the back of your pew there, you'll find a slip of paper with three songs on it, some verses from three songs.
Is Diane working tonight?
Stand up.
Where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me
faith, the peace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, be with you all. The grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all and bring us together tomorrow as well. Amen.
Amen.